This is the day that the Lord has made. I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. Anybody else? Amen. Want to join with me today and just rejoice of the goodness of the Lord?
Amen.
Amen. He is good. He is good to us. I want to open this service today with a testimony that happened to me. You know, us preachers are very human as well. And you'll understand this in just a second what I mean. During one of the most recent snowstorms, I was carrying something in the driveway, and it was like a cartoon, I promise you. My feet slipped out, I went airborne, and wham, right on the asphalt. I sat there for a minute, and I thought, dear Lord, I have broke something. I mean, you know, I'm kind of seeing stars, and you know what I'm talking about. Somebody slipped before. And I got up and I thought, oh man, I am hurting. And then I got nervous. You know that nervous feeling that you get when you know something's wrong? So I got done what I needed to do and I kind of hobbled in the house. And Ann said, what's wrong? I said, babe, I just fell. And she said, you okay? I said, I don't know. And so I went, you know, as guys does, I'll tough it out and I'll just see what happens. Well, I went to bed that night, and I got up the next day, and it was hurting worse. It was in my lower back, and I went to work, and I made it through the day somehow, and I got home that night, and laying in bed that night, I really don't want to go to the doctor. I'm not a fan of doctors. I don't know. Maybe you are. I don't like going. Don't like going to the ER, none of it. I just prayed that simple prayer, Lord, I just don't want to go to the doctor. I can't explain exactly what happened, but I'll just tell you my experience. In the middle of the night, exactly where the pain was on the lower back, I felt a hand come down and touch it. And it all of a sudden started getting real warm. Well, I was getting uncomfortable because it hurt. So I started shifting, and I tried to move away from it, but no matter how I shifted, I felt the pressure keep applying to my back. I woke up the next day and, you know, naturally you're like, ooh, my back's going to hurt. And all of a sudden I started twisting and I started moving and I didn't feel any pain. And then I asked Ann, I said, did you reach over in the middle of the night and touch me? And she said, no, I didn't. I can only say one thing to you today. Look what the Lord has done. Look at how he heals and he touches today. Hey, you're in a house today in a place where God can do the same thing for you today. Whatever your need is today, God can do it for you. This is a house of hope. This is a house of faith. This is a place where God meets his people. So if you have a need today, I challenge you to reach up, to touch God with just a simple prayer. It doesn't have to be elaborate today. Just say, Lord, I need you. And when you do that, he responds with your faith today, and he'll touch you. He'll heal you today. He'll take care of everything that you have need of today. Amen. Why don't you stand with us? We're going to open with prayer today. I want you to do one more thing for me. I want you to release your faith today. Not your doubt, your faith. We can all see negative today in our world, in our lives, in our situations. But why don't we see what God can do in this house? Why don't you lift your hands right now in the name of Jesus? God, we welcome you, God, into this place, Lord. We welcome, God, your spirit, God, to fall into this house today, God. God, we want you here more than anything else, God. We want, God, you to inhabit the worship, God, and the praises of your people today, God. We want you to be a God in the aspect of our giving today, God. We want you, God, to be present in the preaching today, God. We want you to be present, God, and moving in the altar call today, God. Oh, God, let us release our faith, God, to see the impossible take place in this house. To see, God, you move mightily, God, and touch, God, every life and every heart. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Come on, lift your voice right now. Give God glory and honor. Hallelujah. Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
I'm here to worship. I'm here to worship.
miracle worker, promise keeper, guide in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Provided for you. Has he been there for you? I wonder if you can lift up your hands in this place and worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the God of all, because he's still moving mountains and he's still working in our lives today. I've seen it in my own life. He's brought me through situations that I didn't think I would make it out alive, and he's still moving. Hallelujah.
I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it.
Jesus, thank you, Lord God, for being a mountain mover, Lord. Waymaker, thank you, Jesus. Oh, we worship you. Oh, that's wonderful. Worship him for making the way. Oh, Lord, we worship you for all the times, God, that you made a way for us, Lord. Oh, God, we worship you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. I'm so glad I'm amongst a group of people today that don't need to say what way. I think we've all seen how God's moved in our lives, moved that mountain. I'll tell you, I think that song is my theme song. Praise God. It's just, oh, Lord, you are so awesome. It's so good to see everybody here today. Thank you for being with us and celebrating the Lord today with us in this wonderful day of hope. Just have a couple things coming up. We have now this is for the ages 4 to 11 and for the parents or adults that bring them. We're going to have a Valentine pizza party. For who? I could get into big trouble if I said it was for everyone. So it's for the kids ages 4 to 11 and for their parents. It'll be a great time. That is going to be on Saturday, February 12th from 5 to 7 p.m. There'll be pizza, games, and crafts. And if you have any more or need any more information on that, I'm sure that Jody or Renee could help you out with that. Also, this Sunday, as you can see, we're starting off last Sunday of the month with one service. We're going to go back to that. That was always our schedule in the past, or at least it had been. So the last Sunday of the month, there'll be just one service at 10 o'clock. Amen. Let's just ask the Lord to, as we go into this service here, that our minds are prepared to just believe God for great and awesome things. We just sang those songs that he's a way maker, a mountain mover. Lord God, we go to you this morning, God. We're so thankful, Jesus. God, that we know you, that we know your name, Lord. Lord, that we have the privilege, Jesus, of knowing, God, that you are the God of everything. Lord, we thank you for increasing our faith today, Lord. Increasing our faith to believe you, God, for the needs that we have, Lord. Lord, you are a merciful God. Lord, whether we need salvation today, whether we need a healing for our body, whether we need a financial miracle, God, or an emotional one, Lord. Lord, we thank you, God, for being the God of all, Lord. God, you have a name for every need that we need, Lord God. And we worship you today. We worship you. We worship you. We magnify you. We glorify you today, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. If you have an offering, you feel free to come up front and bring it up and drop it in one of these baskets here.
If you know it.
Worship you for me.
For heaven, what are we going to do when we walk those gates? Whenever we see Jesus face to face, what are you going to do? Are you going to stand there? Are you going to out worship? I think it'll be too overwhelming. I think we would all raise our hands and we would be speaking in tongues. We would be dancing. We'll be running. We'll be overwhelmed with the presence of everything that He is. And we give Him all of our worship. That's what heaven is. That's all we'll do is worship. So I think we should do that now and start praising His name like never before, because He is good.
And I will not be silent. I will always worship You. As long as I am breathing, I will always worship You. Worship.
as Christ the Lord. We enter into his gates with praise and thanksgiving. We give him glory today. We worship him. We acknowledge him, our Savior. We acknowledge him, the giver of breath. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We worship. We worship. We worship. It's okay to take a little time right now and just let him know you love the Lord. I love you, Lord. Oh, praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Oh, my God, my God, my God, my God, my God. Holy. Glory, hallelujah. Oh, praise you. Thank you, Lord. I'll be silent.
And I will not be silent.
Oh, I can't be silent to you. I love it whenever the words that we're singing as we are watching them turn on the screen there on the wall behind us, becomes more than just words on a screen. It becomes, amen, the declaration from the heart. It becomes more than just a song. It becomes a confession. Hallelujah. Amen. Receive our worship. He does receive our worship today. You've been standing for about 35 minutes, so I won't keep you up much longer, but I would like for you to turn in the word of the Lord with me today, if you would, to two passages of Scripture. The first one being Deuteronomy chapter number 29. The second one being Psalms chapter number 31. So good to have everyone here today. God bless you. So good to wake up on a Sunday morning and not have to shovel snow. Why do these snowstorms have to come in on Saturday night or Sunday mornings? And so many of our folks last week headed this way and then had to turn around due to ice on the roads and plows that just couldn't keep up with the demand. But thank God today for sunshine, a little warmer temperatures. Praise God. If this is your first time at First Apostolic Church, which I look around and I think it could be a number of you, I'm Pastor Cox. Welcome to a place that loves to worship God, and a place that is seeking God with all of our heart for what He has revealed. We believe that He has revealed much to those that are searching. And today we're going to finalize a series of sermons that I've been preaching all January long on Revelation. A text that we have used this whole time is Deuteronomy 29 and 29. The secret things belong unto the Lord our God. But those things, everyone say, which are revealed, belong unto us and to our children, that we may do all the words of this law. There are secret things of God that we'll never, ever have knowledge of. God doesn't owe us an explanation. He doesn't have to run it by us. He doesn't have to share what He's doing. He's God. He's omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. He's eternal, immortal, invisible. He's God, sovereign. But there are things which are revealed. And the things which are revealed belong to us. We take ownership of those things which God has revealed unto us, and we should never lose them. It's passed to us forever and our children. Amen. Psalms chapter number 31, and we're going to look at a few verses of Scripture, beginning with verse number 1. We're going to read 1, 2, and 3, and then verse number 24. In thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Let me never be ashamed. Deliver me in thy righteousness. Bow down thine ear to me. Deliver me speedily. Be thou my strong rock for an house of defense to save me. For thou art my rock and my fortress. Therefore, for thy name's sake, lead me and guide me. Verse number 24. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Amen. All ye that hope in the Lord. Amen. Be of good courage. Strengthen your heart, all ye that hope in the Lord. And the verse they got up now, we'll go to in just a moment as well. I want to speak today about the revelation of hope. The revelation of hope. Why don't you put your Bibles down, and why don't we just close our eyes for just a moment and say, God, speak hope to each one today. Speak hope to each one. In all of our lives, God, we need a revelation of hope. All of our lives, God, we need a revelation of hope. For we live in a dark world, God, that is trying to steal hope from the hearts of each and every one of us. Despair, despondency rules the day, but God, you are the giver of hope. You're revealing what we have to hope in. I thank you for it today, God, and I pray that you would bless all that's going to transpire for the next few minutes. In Jesus' name we pray. Everyone say amen. Because you have come to the house of God today, this building that's dedicated unto God, is a testimony that you are a person of hope and that you are gathered with people of hope. So take a moment, look around and smile at others that are filled with hope as well. You can wave to them if you'd like, fist bump them, shake their hand if you're feeling comfortable. But this is a house of hope today. Thank God for hope. And you may be seated. And all the creaking bones say hallelujah. Oh. We apostolics get so excited we forget to sit down sometimes. Amen. Our text today in Psalms chapter number 31. Psalms is a great book. It's kind of like a mini Bible all in itself. You can read in the book of Psalms, those 150 chapters, and experience really all of the emotions that life offers. You can sense in the psalmist's writings, of which there are many psalmists, of course, but their experience with life and their recognition of God in their lives. Just because we're Christian doesn't mean that we expect never to have a problem. I'm sorry if somebody told you that if you give your life to the Lord, if you allow him to save you, that you will experience no pain, no suffering, no sorrow. That is not the case. That is not the case. We live in a fallen world. We are people that have to deal with a fallen world. Amen. Amen. We have a whole bunch of things that are not right yet in this world. But someday, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but someday all that's wrong is going to be made right. Thank you. Someday when Christ Jesus returns, everything is going to be as it should have been all along, as it was meant to be. And we are going to experience life as never before. I'm referencing, of course, the millennial reign of Christ, 1,000 years of his rule as king over this earth, and all that are saved will be with the Lord in heavenly dimensions as well as this earthly domain, going back and forth as so necessary. And then following that 1,000 years, we don't know what happens because it doesn't stop. The time frame does, but eternity goes on and on and on and on and on. But the psalmist here in Psalms chapter number 31 is expressing deep emotion. He's expressing how he is needing deliverance. That if God doesn't hear him, which is referenced there in verse 2 of bow down thine ear unto me, Lord. If you don't hear me, and if you don't deliver me, and if you don't save me, I have no hope. I have no one else to help me. There's no other defense. I need you, Lord, to lead me and guide me and direct me, verse number 3, and do so for thy name's sake. Roland Prothero said, the book of Psalms contains the whole music of the heart of man, strummed like a harp by the hand of his maker. In it are gathered the lyrical bursts of his tenderness, the moan of his penitence, the deep experience of his sorrow, the triumph of his victory, the despair of his defeat, and the firmness of his confidence, and ultimately the rapture of his assured hope. You can't read the book of Psalms and not come away with hope. Hope wins out in the book of Psalms. Hope wins against all of the enemies that the psalmists face in every chapter. Hope always delivers those that have placed their confidence in God, even if it means hope that raptures them up out of death or gives them confidence as they face their final hour. Oh, what a blessed hope we have. The writer said, if we had hope in Christ only in this life, we would be of all men most miserable. I was talking with one beloved member of this congregation just this morning about a loved one of theirs that probably soon will be receiving that glorious reward of life eternal with the Lord Jesus. And while pain is racking the body and age has caught up, what a blessed hope he has to know that it doesn't end in a grave. It begins. It begins. The rapture of his assured hope, Roland Prothero said. Hope that raises the heart of man. Many definitions can be found for hope, but let's use this simple one. Hope is a confident expectation. It's not just an expectation, but it's a confident expectation. It is something that you can't explain necessarily how you know it's going to come to pass, but you have confidence. You have confidence in God. You have confidence in His Word. We've been looking this last month at the things that God has revealed, and we begun with how God has revealed Himself. The greatest revelation of all is that God would manifest Himself in flesh so that we that are flesh and blood could understand Him better. He came to our world in a form that we could relate to. If God hadn't become man, then it would be impossible for us really to relate to God. But God did. Jesus Christ is God manifest in the flesh. We believe that. We know that He came for the purpose of carrying the sins of the world. And His death, burial, and resurrection is the good news. Amen. That we also can have resurrection. The great revelation of Himself. And then we went the next week into the revelation of His Word. That the Bible is not just a historical record. It's not just a mere book of fable and story, but it is literally God speaking to mankind. And we looked a little bit at how holy men of God, the Bible says, spake as they were moved on by the Holy Spirit, that the Word of God is inspired by the Holy Spirit. It's through the personality and the pen of people, of course, but it's inspired by God. It was breathed through them, so to speak, as they spake, as they recorded it. It was literally God declaring His Word. And we received that, and our faith is built by the Word of God. Amen. Then we looked at the will of God, the revelation of His will for us, which in many ways is found daily and then also in the future. God has a will for your life. He has a purpose for which you came onto this earth. The will of God. And then last Sunday we looked at the kingdom, the revelation of the kingdom of God. How that already there is this supernatural kingdom that is impacting this world. There's more to the realm of the unseen than we acknowledge, and heavenly dimensions exist all around this dimension of time and space that we're so materially connected to, and that there are things such as angels and there are things such as demons, and that God has allowed His kingdom to become within us through the power of His Holy Spirit. And we, as we are filled with His Spirit, as we live for Christ, that we not only affect the natural, but in the supernatural as well. But hope needs revelation for us. Hope needs to be something that we all leave today with more of in our life. Because Paul writing to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians 13:13, and now abideth faith, hope, and charity. These three, but the greatest of these is charity, of course. But yet, we realize that hope is abiding, just like charity is abiding and faith is abiding in the Believers today have this glorious Christian trifecta of victory, faith, hope, and charity or love that abides with us. The original Greek word for abide is meno, M-E-N-O. And you can also find it in the book, in the Hebrew writings of Yeshab. But both mean to remain and stay. When something abides, it stays there. And Paul is letting us know that hope is abiding with us. Hope is come to stay. Hope doesn't leave you or I. We will leave hope at times. We may come and go from hope, but hope abides. Amen. We see this ebb and flow of hope even in the psalmist of Psalms 43 in verse number 5. The ebb and flow of hope. The psalmist says, "Why art thou cast down, O my soul? And why art thou disquieted within me?" Questions. Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him who is the health of my countenance and my God. Why am I feeling this way? Why am I cast down? Why am I disquieted? The psalmist, like all of us here today, have had experiences where we felt hopeless. We felt cast down. We felt disquieted. But yet a cast down and disquieted soul has a prescription, and that is hope in God. Hope not in circumstances, hope not in money, hope not in your fellow man, but ultimately hope in God. Hope in God that leads us to praise God. Hope in God that leads us to say, I will not be silent. I cannot be silent because my hope is in God. Hope raptures our heart when we remember God. Hope raptures our heart when we abide where hope abides. If hope remains, if hope abides, we need to know where that is. Amen. Just about 20 minutes from here, heading north on 94, you've probably seen, amen, a big church, mega church on the side of it, which has these letters, House of Hope. I love that. I've always thought what a great name for a church. But every church, every family of God has this same opportunity to have hope in their house. Hope abides. Hope abides. Hebrews 3 and 6, hope abides because Christ, as the son over his own house, whose house are we. Notice that. We are of his household. And so if Christ abides in this home, in this house, and we are part of his household, we can also hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope unto the end. There's a danger, though, in not having an established hope. Ephesians 4, 17 through 19 says, "This I say therefore and testify in the Lord that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk in the vanity of their mind, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart." Verse 19, "who being past feeling have given themselves over unto lasciviousness to work all uncleanliness with greediness." Right. Amen. Amen. Paul noted in the Gentiles that weren't saved, that they had reached a place where emotionally they had lost all sense of ability to feel. They couldn't feel anything. We're not just talking about maybe having a day of, you know, being stoic, but we're talking about they had no feeling at all. And so to get a feeling of some sort, they had to give themselves over to lasciviousness. That seemed to awaken emotion within them in some manner as they worked uncleanliness and as they allowed their greed to manifest. They had a little bit of feeling, but being past feeling, Paul said, these individuals are. They have become callous, insensible, apathetic. And not only that, their understanding is darkened. Their understanding has been blinded, and now it requires a revelation. I may be preaching today to some individuals that have a blindness concerning hope in their life, that hope has seemed to become dark. It's gone dark in their life. So we preach about it. but also helping me here today to illustrate this message are four individuals that are going to come up at this time. They're going to take about 2 minutes each, if that, and they are going to share how God has revealed hope to them. Sitting over there is Sister Cadence and Brother Kelvin and Sister Becker and then Brother Feuerstein. Why don't you give them a big old hand as they one by one come up and share how God has revealed hope to them.
Amen. Okay, so when I was asked to do this, I had one thing that immediately came to my mind that I continue to pray about because I wanted God to, you know, really show me that this was what I was supposed to speak about. So before I start, I looked up some words for hope, some other words. Achievement, anticipation, ambition, belief, confidence, desire, and aspiration. So in 2020, a lot of things happened that year, obviously, and that was a big year for me as a 16-year-old girl. I decided that I was going to really grow in my spiritual life like I needed to and not just live through my parents' ministry, which can be easy growing up in a minister's home. That year was the year that we started the Bible bread chart, and I thought, you know what, I'm going to do this. I'm going to keep up with it, and it's January, and we have absolutely no clue what's about to happen in March, and I was just so excited for it, and I kept up with it, and around March is whenever we all go to youth convention. I was already going through some things personally in my life that was a little bit hard. And then COVID hit. And we got around to convention and they said it was canceled. And that is a huge thing for the youth group, huge thing for me. It's always a life-changing experience. And that was very, very discouraging. And we kept hearing, you know, like camp was getting canceled and all of these different events. And I was so upset. And I remember this one night, I was sitting in my room. I had my Bible in front of me, just opened. And I was just crying. And I was like, God, I need you to show me something. I need you to give me some hope because I've lost it all. And in that moment, God spoke to me. And he told me to open up to Jeremiah 29:11. And at the time, I did not have that verse memorized. So I'm like, okay, you know, I hope this is not just me trying to convince myself of something. But I really felt like God wanted me to open that up. And I went to it, and it says, "For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, thus saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not evil, to give you an expected end," or as other verses say, "a hope for the future." And I broke down. I mean, I was bawling my eyes out. And I knew that was God, you know. That was God showing me exactly what I needed in that moment. And it was an amazing thing for me. And I thought, you know what, God, I'm going to put this in your hands. All of these things that I'm dealing with, all of this disappointment that I have, all of these trials that we're going through, I'm going to put it in your hands. And I did. And throughout that year, it was like a bubble. Everything going on, I was in a bubble with God. And the peace was so overwhelming, something I've never felt before in my life. And it lasted that entire year. And yes, it was a frustrating year. Yes, there was a lot of things that hurt me. But nothing could shake that peace and that hope that I had. It was amazing. There was times I would be reading the Word just so in tune, like it was like tunnel vision on the Word. And I was almost scared to look to my right because God's presence was so strong. I thought I was about to see Jesus sitting next to me. It was amazing. And God kept me. And he followed through on that promise that he gave me through that verse. He has kept me and he has provided for me. And he brought me through so many things. That hope is still continuing. And God is just amazing. I give everything to him because I would not be here without him.
You can be a young person and know the hope of God. Amen. Brother Kelvin's coming at this time. He's coming with his crutches. He's coming with his foot, but he's coming with hope today.
Amen. I got pretty good on these things. I'll set them down, though. So I've had a nice little vacation the last year now, and I'm sure it's not been a vacation for the people around me because I get chauffeured around. They got a chauffeur me around. But the night of the accident, when I wrecked my truck, the night of the accident, I guess the only way I can explain it and the part I remember is I was just laying in my truck. The way I was laying, there's no way in the world it could have been comfortable, but the only way I can explain it is I was laying in God's hand, and I had perfect peace. Nothing bothered me, and the only thought I could think, the only thought I was physically able to think was, it's going to be okay. Doesn't matter. And that's all I could think was, it's going to be okay. And then after my mind started finally going, it didn't matter. I was sitting there thinking, oh, they got cool prosthetics. I could get something cool, but that didn't have to happen. So they put me back together. I'll just leave it at that. And when I was down the first time, I had pins in my ankles, so I couldn't do much. I was in a cast just like this. And decided to read Psalms in the Bible for the Bible bread chart. I was reading Psalms, so I had a lot of hope. I was pretty confident the first time around, and so then they pulled the pins out, and I started doing therapy again and walking on it. And about a month after that, something wasn't right. I knew something wasn't right, and there was concerns with. I knew there would be concerns, and one of the concerns was the bones dying. I guess bones need constant blood flow, and the ankle bone dying was a main concern. And sure enough, that ended up being the case. And so I was waiting for an MRI to verify that if that was the case. Well, fortunately, I had about two and a half months between November, December, and the beginning of January, between switching doctors and this and that. And during that time, I was just upset. I was mad. I just felt like this is exactly what I deserved. This is what I deserved. It's what I, based on my actions and choices, this is the path that I chose. And so I finally met the new doctor that was going to do the surgery. I got an MRI, and my first appointment with him was horrible. One, I asked him what the worst case was, and obviously the worst case is cut the leg off, but I knew it wasn't going to go that far. But there was a lot of concerns with the surgery, and the surgery, what they ended up doing was they just screwed the whole ankle bone together with 5 or 6 screws and a plate. Kind of a common surgery, but if your bone is like a sponge, you can't put a screw into anything. So that was a concern. And so when I got home from that appointment, it was earlier in the morning for me, and I wasn't happy. I didn't have any hope. I just felt like it was all over. I just figured I couldn't be able to walk. And so I said, I'll read the Bible. I've kind of just been reading it sporadically, no rhyme or reason. And the verse I had stopped, the next verse was Ezekiel 37. And that reads, 1-8 reads, "The Lord took hold of me, and I was carried away by the Spirit of the Lord to a valley filled with bones. He led me all around among the bones that covered the valley floor. They were scattered everywhere across the ground and were completely dried out. Then he asked me, 'Son of man, can these bones become living people again?' 'O sovereign Lord,' I replied, 'you alone know the answer to that.' Then he said to me, 'Speak a prophetic message to these bones and say, dry bones, listen to the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says. Look, I am going to put breath into you and make you life again. I will put flesh and muscles on you and cover you with skin. I will put breath into you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord.'" And I think the pattern between me and Cadence is we got a direct word from the Lord, and I just broke down. And that was That was everything I needed at that time. And, you know, it wasn't easy. It wasn't sunshine and rainbows after that. You know, I still had my ups and downs, but God gave me something to hope for. He gave me something to look to. He gave me a direct word that in the bad times, all I had to do was go read that again. When I felt like I was not all there and just needed something, I mean, He gave me a direct word that I could go back to and obtain that hope. And as simple as it sounds, I think the main thing I learned through all this was coming to church just wasn't enough. It had to be a daily thing, a sacrificial daily thing. And the more time I gave God, the more opportunities I give Him to give me hope. And that's been my process. And I guess I've kind of enjoyed going through this, not in a way, but, you know, I've got to grow a lot through it, and I've obtained a lot of hope through it.
Amen. How many also have experienced a direct word from the Lord in a time that you need it? He was just reading through the Bible, and he came to that great portion of Scripture about the dry bones coming alive. And when he had his surgery, the doctor said, "Your bones are going to be all right." Amen. Sister Becker, come and share. This is a woman of filled with hope. She's had multiple revelations.
Well, first of all, I'm going to say I'm so, so thankful for God's unconditional love. We are all valued. We are all cherished. And we are chosen by the sovereign God of the universe to be His own. Each of our lives is a story, and God knows your story. God knows what makes you happy and what troubles you. He's asking you to cast all your cares upon Him, to hope in Him, to bring all your hurts, your fears, your failures, your scars, your insecurities, your wrongs, your sicknesses, your hardships, et cetera, and et cetera, and et cetera, to Him. Our help comes from the Maker of heaven and earth, the one who knows your name and has all authority and power. Jesus came to bring abundant life to each of us. Thank you, Lord, for the finished work of the cross, the death, the burial, the resurrection. God wants us to claim for ourselves promises He has made available to us. There are over 3,000 promises, such as He will never leave or forsake you. He wants to fight your battles. He is on your side. He is our refuge and strength in the time of trouble. Years ago, I was diagnosed with colorectal cancer. I wanted to be right with the Lord. I repented thoroughly of my sins. I cast the care of cancer on the Lord. This church was praying for me in the name of Jesus. My family was bombarding heaven on my behalf. I believe the Lord led me to a verse, 1 John 4:17. As He is, so are we in this world. Now, the verse is speaking of Jesus. As Jesus is, so are we in this world. Jesus does not have tumors. Jesus does not have cancer. Jesus has no fear. Jesus is victorious. As Jesus is, so are we in this world. So I took that verse for myself. As Jesus is, so is Bonnie Becker in this world. After treatment, my next step was the surgeon. He came to my husband and myself amazed, declaring, "The cancer is gone." Thank you, Jesus. There is nothing there. If I didn't know you and you came off the street, I would have given you a clean bill of health. Thank you, Jesus. And that's been over 8 years. By Jesus' stripes, I am healed and made whole. The blood of Jesus will never lose its power. The living and infallible word of God will never lose its power. The name above every name will never lose its power. We can all have hope in God. Yes. To God be the glory forever and ever.
Hallelujah.
Oh, let's give the Lord a big hand of praise. Hallelujah. Thank God. Last but not least, Brother Chris Feuerstein is coming to share what the Lord has done for him. Praise God.
Good morning, everyone. Now, I could give this testimony without reading it, but it would be a lot longer than 2 minutes. So, my journey of faith for God's healing started in 1998 when I was diagnosed with a ruptured disc after having occasional back spasms for several years. Although the doctors wanted to start planning for treatment and surgery, I felt impressed by the Lord to not do that, but to believe that He would heal me. In fact, I felt that if I did go forward with the surgery, it would not be successful. The Lord gave me hope and peace, and the scripture Isaiah 40 and 31 to stand on. Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This healing of my back did not happen immediately. In fact, my pain got worse. But the Lord gave me the gift of faith during that whole time. Don't pretend to be a superstar in faith. Get this, God gave me a gift of faith. In fact, the worse the pain got, the more I believed that He was going to do it. I wish I could say that was me every day. But God, that's exactly how I felt. After 9 months, I was completely healed, and I've never had a back issue since. So my latest step in this journey of faith happened more recently. Last summer, after encountering some lingering pain in another part of my body, I was diagnosed with a serious health issue. In fact, the day after I got the report, a leading hospital in the Chicagoland area was calling me already to set me up for an immediate visit for more testing and surgery. After discussing with my wife, we agreed not to make any quick decisions. I began to again feel the hope and the leading of the Lord to not proceed with the medical route, but to trust Him instead and put my hope in Him. This time, I did not immediately get the gift of faith. And after 3 more weeks, my faith level was on empty. I was so exhausted emotionally and spiritually that I was ready to give in, telling my wife, "I'm calling the doctors on Monday." But in fact, this did not happen. And the next day, the Lord gave me an unbelievable dose of faith and the strength to believe again that He was going to heal me. Over the next several weeks, God kept impressing me that I needed strength, spiritual strength. And He would even say, "You need that more than you need your healing. You need spiritual strength for faith," is what He was telling me. I remember sitting there where Sister Cox is, looking up at the banners on the platform. And if you recall, we had one on the left and one on the right. One on the left said, "The Lord strengthened," with reference to Isaiah 40 and 29, which says, "He gives power to the weak, and to those who have no might, he increases strength." And the one on the right said, "Strengthened in faith." Now, those banners had been there for months, but I had never really seen them. I'd seen them, but not seen them. And I can't tell you, after being impressed by the Lord that I needed strength and looking up there and seeing those, it was like, okay, God, I'm getting it. I'm getting it. So this was, again, just one more confirmation that I was hearing from God. Then it was absolutely amazing, the preaching that I heard come from this pulpit over the next several weeks. Pastor Cox preached a message on August 23rd. God is so motivated to answer prayer. He encouraged us to pray big prayers, impossible prayers. Don't pray little prayers, big prayers. Don't be afraid that God's going to say no. He said sometimes we're afraid to pray a big prayer because we think God might say no. Brother Rodney Kidder then preached a message on September 5th, unwavering faith in the promises of God. And he stated that God will give you provision for every step in your journey. Hallelujah. On September 19th, Brother Fox preached an anointing message, and then a tongues and interpretation was given. He said, "I have set the flood that I might show my strength in your life." I can't tell you the impact that these preaching had on me to strengthen me, because I knew that God was speaking to me and encouraging me every step along the way. It was a step-by-step journey. So you might be thinking, did you ask God if he was going to heal you? Well, I started to, but he reminded me, I already have in my word. I don't need to tell you again. What I needed strength and faith to believe. 1 Peter 2 and 24, the word that he had already given was that by his stripes you were healed. And Psalms 103, verse 3, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, who forgives all my iniquities and who heals all my diseases." Psalms 107 and 20 says, "He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions." So the Lord already gave me a word about my healing. So he revealed hope to me through his word as I began every day by speaking to the mountain. We sang about the mountain today being moved. And I began to speak every day to the mountain, as found in Mark 11, 22 through 24. So today I stand before you healed and totally confident that God does keep his word. Praise the Lord.
Can we stand and clap our hands unto the Lord right now and give God praise? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Be seated for just a few more moments. Hebrews 11 and 1 says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." I feel faith in the house today. My faith has been increased by these testimonies and by the word that we have already shared. Amen. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter number 6, verses 17 through 19, "Wherein our God is willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of the promise the immutability of his counsel. He confirms it with an oath, Two immutable things. It's impossible for God to lie. In that we have strong consolation. We have fled to him for refuge. We lay hold upon the hope that is set before us. Which hope we have, everyone say, is an anchor. Hope is an anchor of my soul, both sure and steadfast, which entereth into the veil. I believe today that God is wanting to tether somebody's storm. You might be in a ship on the stormy sea of life, but God wants to tie you to an anchor called hope today. He wants to put hope so deep within, amen, that your life, that you will not be tossed about any longer, that you will leave here today able to say, I believe God, no matter what, is going to see me through. I am confident in him. He cannot lie. I have an hope that is an anchor for my soul. Hosea chapter number 2 and verse number 15, and I conclude. The Bible speaks of Israel, and the Lord says concerning Israel, calling her a vineyard, I will give her a vineyard from thence, and the valley of Achor for a door of hope. The valley of Achor is one of the most discouraging valleys in all of Scripture. It was in that valley that we see a tremendous sin was committed that required judgment from God. It became a memorial for all of Israel, of just how whenever you do wrong, bad things can happen in your life, that the devil doesn't offer you any good things in life. And so for generation after generation, whenever you would go to the Valley of Achor, you would leave discouraged, you would leave depressed, you would leave feeling like there was no hope. But the Bible says this, that God put a door of hope in the valley of Achor. I don't know what valley you may be in your life right now. You may be in a valley of pain. You may be in a valley of financial difficulty. You may be in a valley of grief. You may be in a valley of hopelessness. But I have come to say with these that have testified that in that valley, in that valley, God puts doors. And you don't just come to the door and say, well, it's locked, I guess I can't go. No, this door is an open door. Hope is an open door. And we today, myself, our team of prayer leaders, and I want to conclude this service by inviting every single person that would want to walk through a door called hope today to do so. A door that is wide open. A door that is established in the Word of God. A door that when you go through it, you will bring with you from that day forward an anchor of hope. You will bring with you from that day forward a hope that'll conquer all of the despair. Oh, praise God. Can we just worship the Lord for a few moments right now? How many has ever walked through that door of hope? How many has ever walked through that door of hope? Oh, hallelujah. Before you reached the door, you were in the valley. Before you found the door, you felt like there was nothing worth living. But you found the door. There was a door. You walked in faith through that door of hope. And on the other side, things began to look different. On the other side, problems began to change in your life. And you began to believe for a future that you didn't know you had. You began to live as it was spoken of, almost as in some kind of bubble. You got a word from the Lord like these that testified that God gave them direct words. Oh, hallelujah. Or you were reminded, like Brother Feuerstein said, I have already heard these words. And what I have already heard now has begun to come to pass in my life. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Glory to God, 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 glory to God. Hallelujah. So this is how we're going to end this service today. This is what we believe to do. Amen. We believe, first and foremost, for all of us to pray together. But I would like those members of our prayer team that have been asked to go about the building, the various portions of the walls, to do so at this time, if they would. And I want them, wherever they end up, to stretch their hand towards all that are around us. These prayer team leaders right here are people that pray every day. They pray every day for needs that come through our internet, that come through the phone, different things. I want them to stretch their hand out towards all of us here today. And if you, like me, like all of us, want to walk through the door of hope, if you want to walk through the door of hope today, I want you to stretch your hands up towards heaven as well. What we're going to do first and foremost is we're going to confess our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, that He offers us a door. We're going to repent of our sins. We're going to ask God to forgive us of anything that might keep us back from going through that door. Anything that would cause me to hesitate from walking through the door. I don't want anything to block me from my blessing today. Would you reach out to God right now in the name of Jesus? Lord, we confess that You put doors of hope in the valleys that we can walk through. We confess that You, God, are able to give us hope today, no matter what we may feel, no matter what we may face, no matter what we may go through, no matter how our lives might have been up to this point. We are together as one group of people acknowledging You today to be the giver of hope. Forgive us of our sins, God. We repent. Anything that would keep us from walking through the door, God, I pray right now that You would break every bond of iniquity, that You would remit every sin, that You would set every captive free, that Your anointing would destroy every yoke today, that there would be deliverance in this place today. We plead the blood of Jesus and we call for the angels to come and minister. We pray for the blessings of heaven to fall like dew in this place. Almighty God, we know that You're the healer of our body, soul, and spirit. And right now we confess with our mouth that which we believe in our heart, that You are Jehovah Rapha, the God that heals. You are Jehovah Jireh, the God that provides. You are all that we need. You supply our every need today. And Lord, we thank You that we can walk through a door called hope today and experience the mighty blessings of God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Those prayer team leaders that have been asked to help us with a prayer line across the front, if you would get in your positions. Pastor Rodney Kidder and our other minister, Brother Bob Bowski, if you would get in your positions up by the pews there, the front pews. Here's what we're going to invite you to do. Those of you that would like to walk through a door, so to speak, of hope today, we would like for you to stand and make your way to the edge of the building. If you're on this side, go to the wall over there. If you're on this side, go to the wall over there. Those of you prayer team leaders, if you would get across from one another here, stretch forth your hand. Sister Janet can give a little direction to the prayer team. If you would want to walk through this door, this hallway, so to speak, we invite you to step to the wall. What you're going to do is you're going to come down. Our ministers are going to put an oil of anointing upon you. The Bible says, anoint them with oil and pray the prayer of faith, and the Lord shall deliver them. Then you're going to walk through this door and these prayer